Hello everyone, thank you for joining my session. I'm Abhik and I work as a database engineer at Experian. And today I'm going to talk about Neteza. So for this presentation, let's keep the questions towards the end of the presentation so we can keep a better track of the time. So these are the topics that we are going to cover in Neteza. Right? So I'm not going to read through all of these, but if you look at the topic, you will see that these are actually the things that you need to know today in the DB2 space to be able to work as a DB2 database consultant. Right? So that's the very idea of my topic. What I want to do is I want to tell you all the things that you need to know about Neteza. So in the future, if your management is talking about it, you know what it would mean and what it would take to bring that piece of technology into your shop. And you know how you would be able, you will be able to know what to do to be able to support this implementation. So that's my topic. So what is this whole Neteza appliance all about, right? So Neteza is an appliance. It's just like any appliance. It's a plug and play feature. You need minimal setup and tuning. It's a dedicated device to do only one thing very well. Okay, think about it. You don't want to buy a blender and use it as a grinder, right? So that's the very purpose of Neteza. It's built in for a very, very specific workload. It brings processing close to data through FPGAs. Now, this is something very unique to Neteza, and I'm going to cover this in detail in the future slides, how this happens. So the data is, the processing is actually moved closer to data with the FPGAs in Neteza system. It's actually a relational database engine that's built on PostgreSQL. And this appliance is called the IBM PO Data for analytics. So let's see some other relational database appliances that are there in the landscape today. So you have IBM PO Data for operational analytics. And this appliance is actually running DB2 data partitioning feature. These are actually evolved from the earlier balance configuration units. You have Oracle Exadata, and you have Teradata Data Warehouse Appliance. And this is not an exhaustive list. There are others in the landscape as well. So the IBM Pure Data for Analytics, right, is actually the Neteza appliance. So it's a bit confusing of how they, you know, the names are. So let's look at the Neteza architecture, how this whole thing works. So the Neteza architecture can be compared very closely to DB2, running on a data partitioning feature, which is DPF. So how does a DPF, DB2 DPF actually work? So if you think, look at this example, you have a DB2 coordinator partition, right? And all of the SQL requests from the different clients come to the coordinator partition. And this coordinator partition then actually breaks that work and gives it to each of the individual database partitions in DB2, okay? Each of these database partitions has its own CPU, memory and disk. So it takes its own part of data, it does the processing, and it gives the data back to the coordinator partition. And then this partition will, the coordinator will merge all the work requests and send it back to the clients. This is the overall understanding of how a DB2 DPF environment will work. Neteza is very close to that. So in Neteza, the coordinator partition is actually called the SMP host. This is actually a Linux system. It's running Red Hat Enterprise Linux, and this SMP host will accept all the client requests for SQLs. It breaks it down and it gives it to each of the individual SPUs available to Neteza. What is SPU? SPU is a snippet processing unit. Think of it, compare it as same as a database partition in DB2 DPF. Each of the SPU will have its own CPU, memory, the disk, and FPGAs. So this is the extra thing that's there. So each of the SPUs will do their part of the work. It will give the data back to the SMP host. The SMP host will merge all the requests and send it back. So you see the whole architecture is very, very similar to a DPF environment. Now this slide shows the building blocks that are used in a Neteza system. So since Neteza is an appliance, they have different models of Neteza out there in the market. So you have Neteza 1000, then it evolved to 2001, 2002, and so forth. The fundamental concept of the design is still the same. The only difference is between the number of CPUs it comes, the amount of memory that comes with the appliance. So those are the ones that keep changing. So let's take an example here, how this whole architecture looks. So the example here is going to show you a single rack system, okay? But a Neteza appliance can be delivered in multiple racks as well. You can have a 5-rack system, 10-rack system, depending on how large your data set is. So let's look at this. So you have the SMP host, which we covered in the last slide. So this will get all the client requests. And this rack will have 2 storage arrays. Each storage array has 48 1-terabyte disks here. Okay, and these yellow boxes are the spare disks. So you have two storage arrays, storage array 1 and 2. And then you have the S-blade chassis here. So you have 2 S-blade chassis, and each S-blade chassis has 6 blade servers. Okay, so these are all the blade servers. Each blade server has 8 CPUs, 16 GB RAM, and 8 FPGAs. So this is just an example. Now, these can keep changing depending on the appliance. So in this example, the ratio of CPU to memory to disk to FPGAs is 1:1 to 2:1, okay? Because RAM is 16 GB. So this is the ratio of your processing unit in this example. How does SQL flow in a Neteza system? So let's look at how this happens in DB2. So to process an SQL statement, multiple things needs to be done. So if your data is in the disk, it will first need to be uncompressed. And then data will need to be projected. Now what is projection? Let's say you have 10 columns in a table and you are only requiring 3 columns, right? So that's called projection of a table. So then you need to project your data, you need to uncompress, you need to restrict your data. What is restriction? This is applying the WHERE predicates to your SQL. And finally, you have the aggregate joins and the complex joins and aggregation that's also done. So in a DB2 system, the data gets fetched from the disk, is moved towards the CPU, is placed in the memory area, and all of this work is done by CPUs. So the whole architecture is to move the data from the disk, get it into a memory area, and process it with CPUs. Neteza tackles this problem in a little different way. So what happens is in Neteza, between the disk and your CPUs, you have a farm of FPGAs. These are field programmable gate arrays. These are kind of hardware accelerators. So what they do is, they are going to uncompress, project, and restrict the data for you. The CPUs don't do any of these tasks. By the time your data has reached over here, the subset of the data will have reduced to about 5 to 10% of the original set. And then this data enters the CPU. So the CPU here is only responsible for the aggregation and the complex joins. So you see in a Neteza system, the major heavy lifting is actually done by FPGAs. CPUs are doing very little work in a Neteza system. And that's why typically you will see when you look at Neteza architectures, the CPUs are, you know, the cheaper CPUs and they're not as powerful as a DB2 appliances. Because it really does not depend on the CPUs for much of the work. How do I connect to a database Neteza system? So can I connect to an SPU directly? Like in DB2 DPF, you can connect to a database partition. No, you cannot. The SPUs are sort of hidden from the system, okay? If you do a DF, you cannot see these file systems, which are the SPUs, because it's a hidden system. So you will be connecting to the SMP host, and the SMP host is going to communicate with the Neteza system, with all the SPUs here. The way to connect, there are various third-party applications like Cognos, Agenity. They will use different drivers. You can use ODBC, JDBC, OLEDB drivers to connect. In your machine, you can use PuTTY and SSH, and you will get access to the NZSQL prompt. If you have a Unix application server, you can install this Unix client, CLI client, which will also give you access to the NZSQL prompt. This NZSQL prompt is similar to a DB2 command prompt. So let's look at it in detail. So the DB2 command prompt looks like this, right? We all know about this. This is very familiar to us. Similarly, the Neteza SQL prompt will look like this. So when you're connecting to a Neteza system, if you do not specify any database name, it automatically gets connected to the system database. So you're seeing the system here. Because this is a database, you're automatically connected. So let's say if you had a retail database and if you're connecting to retail, this would be showing as retail. And then admin is the database user ID with which we're connecting. Okay, so this is how this prompt looks like. In DB2, you can run various utilities like DB2 iList through the operating system command prompt. Similarly, Neteza also, you can do the same. So for here, as an example, ngrev is a utility that you're running, which gives you the version of the Neteza appliance that you're running. Okay, so whenever you're creating a DB2 database, the system catalogs will always be in your user database. So if you're creating 10 databases, each of them will have its own system catalogs tables, right? In Neteza for one appliance, you have a system database. And this system database will actually have all the system catalog information for all your database objects in that appliance. Then you have a master DB, which is actually a template that is used for creating user databases when you request it with the create database command. And then you have these user databases. So you see here, you know, it's the fundamental difference is that the system catalogs are all in a different database called system. What are the data types that are supported in Neteza? So DB2 is pretty exhaustive in that sense. So it supports most of the data types supported by Neteza in addition to large objects like XMLs, LOBs, CLOBs, etc. Neteza will, if you see that here, it only supports integers, numeric, decimal, float, Boolean, timestamp. It does not support any of the large data types. Now, why is this so? Because think about it, it's an analytic appliance built for a very, very specific purpose. And typically in an analytic appliance, you really don't need to store large objects. So if you have a need to store large objects, Neteza may not be the option for you. DB2 has, it supports primary key constraints, foreign constraints, null, default, and check constraints. Neteza will only enforce null and default constraints. No other constraints are enforced. No primary keys, no foreign keys. Now, what's the rationale behind this? Again, for typical data warehouse applications or analytic applications, all of that logic should usually be at the application layer. So that's the assumption that Neteza goes with. But you can always mention these primary keys and foreign key statements in the DDL statements. Because in that case, the optimizer will use it for getting efficient access plans. In DB2, the table spaces can be laid out on a subset of database partitions in a DPF environment. And so you have flexibility of how you want to lay your tables across the database partitions in DPF. So you can have a single partition table. You can have a table across a subset of your database partitions or across all. You don't have that option in Neteza. So all tables are always laid across all available SPUs. Okay. In DB2, if you want to do a cross database access, if you want to access objects in another database, you typically use federation. In Neteza, as long as your databases are in the same appliance, you can use this four-part naming convention. So if you say database name, schema name, table name, and column name, you can access column names of another object from a different database. Here, this is a link I've taken from the IBM Knowledge Center. This gives some of the Neteza's maximums and limits. So the two key things here is you can have a maximum of 1600 columns for each table. Now, I hope you are not really seeing this in a real world scenario, because by the time you're hitting this, it's really bad. You need to do something about it. Row size, 65 KB, right? So look at this. This is interesting, because this is really not much compared to what DB2 may provide you. Again, the idea is that you don't have large objects. Okay, you have pretty native data type support. So, you know, your max row is just 65K that it supports. So how is data distributed in Neteza across these SPUs, right, which is a snippet processing units? So the key algorithm is very, very similar. So you see in DB2, there is a hashing algorithm. So what it will do, let's say you create a table and you say distribute by hash and you give the column name, okay? So the hashing algorithm will take this column as an input, and the output of the hashing algorithm will be a number, database partition number, where your row will be going. Neteza does it in a very, very similar fashion. So again, you give the keys for your distribute, and it will put it, the output will be a specific SPU where your data will go. Okay? So how you create it in DB2, you say, you give the create table statement and you say distribute by hash, give the column name. In Neteza, you say distribute on column name. So you see how very similar the whole data distribution algorithms are in Neteza. Again, this is just to repeat that all tables need to be distributed. Not all tables needs to be distributed in DB2. We can have single partition tables as well. Well, Neteza doesn't give you that option. It doesn't allow you to be creative here. So all your tables will always be distributed, okay? But it does give you two options for distribution. So one is the distribute on columns, which we saw here, which is going to use the hashing algorithm. The second option is distribute on random. So what this does, it takes the first row and puts it in a particular SPU. The second row will go to the next SPU and so on. This is just a random distribution. So how does joins work in a Neteza system? Now, since we see that the distribution algorithm is very similar to DB2, then we can assume that the joins that are supported in Neteza will also be very similar. And that is exactly what we see here. So if you see in DB2, in a DPF, we have something called, this is the coveted, everyone wants this, right? The co-located joins. So what is this? When your join columns for the tables in question are the same as the hash keys on the tables, and if there are certain other conditions that needs to be met here in DB2, it produces a co-located join. So in a co-located join, your data does not have to move between the database partitions. It's the most optimum join to achieve. You have the same concept here. You have the co-located joins. Again, because the hashing algorithm is very, very similar. In DB2, you have a directed join when join columns for one of the tables is not the same as the hash keys. Here, data from one of the database partitions will be moving to other partitions to achieve the join. You have the same thing, it's just a different name. It's single distribute joins. And then you have a broadcast join or a directed outer and inner joins, which is when none of your columns participating in the join are the same as the hash keys. Neteza has the same thing, it just calls it broadcast joins or double distribute. So we see here the join strategy is very, very similar. So if you are troubleshooting joins and data distribution in DB2, for you to move into Neteza won't be very difficult because the concepts are all very similar. Some distribution key best practices, integer data types are the best data types for distribution keys. This holds for DB2 as well. Avoid multiple columns as distribution keys. Now why is this? Now if you give multiple columns in your distribution keys, you can achieve even distribution, right? But what you cannot achieve is co-location. Because let's say you are trying to co-locate your joins between two key tables. You just want to join them on the same columns. But if you are giving all these too many columns, you will not be able to do that. And the same reason is you should try not to develop a strategy where you give generated columns as distribution keys. Because again, you will be getting an even distribution of data, but you will not be getting a co-located or an optimal join during your processing. So you'll have a processing skew. Avoid using floating point data types, because these data types, you will not get in Neteza the more efficient joins. Okay, so we should try to avoid floating types if possible. Some other best practices, if you are joining two tables on a particular column name, let's say employee ID, make sure the data types are the same for the two tables, because if the data types are not the same, they will be hashed to different SPUs, right? So you may be thinking that my data types the column name is same. You're not getting a co-located join because the data types are different. And I actually learned it the hard way. Sometimes I oversaw it. It was hard to figure it out later. For small tables, distributing on random is usually a good choice. And do not use 0, 1, true, and false, right? Because then only data will be distributed in two data slices. This is the same holds for DB2 as well. Indexes in Neteza. So Neteza does not have any indexes, right? It sounds crazy, isn't it? It does not have it because it does not need any indexes. So DB2 uses indexes to reduce the need for table scans for SQLs that have a restrict or filtering clause. But we see that Neteza does not have indexes. So Neteza in turn will rely on zone maps to eliminate the unnecessary need for table scans wherever possible. So think about it, that indexes will tell you where data resides. while zone map will tell you where data is not present. There's a fundamental difference between these two things. It's not, a zone map is not an equivalent of indexes. Okay, it just tells you where data is not present. Zone maps are external level pointers to range of column values. We will see this in the future slides. Zone maps, the advantage, it consumes negligible disk space compared to indexes and have a typically lower maintenance overhead. So let's look at a zone map. How does it look like? So in Netezza, the smallest unit of disk allocation is called an extent, which is 3 MB in size, right? So in DB2 also we have an extent size. Now this is divided into smaller chunks, but this, let's not go into those details. So let's, for the sake of this example, let's think that the table on the right, okay, this has columns order ID and client ID. So this is not sorted, okay? And the table on the left is sorted. It is sorted on order ID and client ID. As you can see, the order ID is a major sort, the client ID is a minor sort. So let's see how a zone map gets created. So let's look at this table here. So what the zone map will do, it will say order ID, and let's assume over here the first three rows are extent 1, okay? And let's assume the next four are extent 2. Let's go with that assumption, same over here. So how is the zone maps get, how does it get created for this table? So what it says, order ID minimum is 1, okay? So in extent 1, your order ID minimum value is what? 1, and the max is 2. Let's look at client ID. The minimum is 100, max is 500, right? So similarly for extent 2, you have 3 and max is 5, and client ID 120 and max is 300. So similarly, a zone map can also get created over here. So now let's see how this whole zone map will really help Netezza, because we just said that it helps to reduce unnecessary table scans. So let's take an example where you're trying to fetch rows where your order ID is equal to 5. So let's look at this unsorted table, right? So you see order ID equal to 5 will be present in both extents, right? Because the maximum value is 5 for both of them. So it will need to scan both extents. But over here, order ID equal to 5 is only extent 2. So Netezza needs to scan only extent 2. So what do we see here? What we understand here is that for a zone map to be really effective, your data has to be sorted, nearly sorted, or have a small range. That's what we see here, right? What is the meaning of small range? If your data is sorted, the value between your min and max is going to be small. For an unsorted data, your difference between min and max is usually very large. So it's, that's why they say for unsorted data, you have a larger range. But zone map has a problem. The problem is that it has an order with precedence. So what does order with precedence mean? It means that the major sort will receive the major benefit of the sorting and the minor sort will get lesser benefit. So let's try to go with a quick example here. Let's say you are trying to find all rows where your client ID is equal to 210. Okay? So for client ID is equal to 210, for this sorted table, you see that it needs to scan both extents, which is a minor sort, right? Now let's change, make this as a major sort. Let's just sort the data only on this. So if we sort it, what will we get? We will get 100, 120, 210, and 300. And if we assume that these values are in one extent, just one extent one, it will only need to scan extent this one extent, right? Because 210 is there, here. So that's the reason, what we see is as soon as we change this to a major sort, it's going to get the benefit. So that's the disadvantage of zone map, is that as you are having more and more columns, which are minor sorts, your zone map advantage will keep going down. Things to remember about zone maps. Zone maps are only created for certain data types, like integers, timestamp, date, etc. Zone maps are effective if data is nearly sorted. We saw that. The limitation is order with precedence. We saw that. And only the first 200 columns are zone mappable. So what if you have a situation where you have 210 columns and you want to zone map those? What do we do? There are some options. We'll see that. Zone maps are created for each of the SPUs available to Netezza. Okay, so for each of the SPUs, there's a specific zone map. Zone maps are automatically refreshed during database operations. So to get away with the problem of zone maps, order with precedence, there is something called clustered base tables. So let's see how this looks like. Okay, so let's look at this table here. We say that this table is ordered on order ID and client ID. And let's assume that this is on extend 1 and this is in extend 2. So the zone map for this order table will look like this. Okay. And for a clustered base table, what Neteza will do? It will use a Hilbert space filling curve to put the data into extend. So what it does is, based on the keys that you provide in your clustered base tables, Neteza will keep the rows with the similar keys in same or nearby extents, which is very similar to DB2's MDCs, if you think about it. So what happens over here is, let's say for example, extend 1, right? The values 1 and 1 will go to extend 1. 1 and 3 is put to extend 2. 2 and 2 is put to extend 3 and so forth. So you can see one thing over here is that, yes, the data did get clustered, but now in this plain sorted table, you just needed 2 extents. But here you actually need 5 extents. So that means that when you are creating a clustered base tables, your compression is going to suffer. You need more extents to store the data. But what's the advantage? So let's say I want to find all rows where order ID equal to 2 and client ID equal to 2. Okay? So over here, I just need to scan one extent here. But over here, I would have needed to scan 2 extents. So that's the advantage that we see with the clustered base tables. And then this doesn't have order with precedence. What does this mean? Let's say we want to find rows where order ID equal to 1. Okay? So order ID is a major sort here, right? And this is the minor sort. So order ID equal to 1 needs to scan in this both extents 1 and 2. But it just needs to scan this extent here. So you see, even though this is a major sort, it needs to scan more over here. Let's look at a minor sort. So let's say we want to find rows where client ID equal to 2. Okay? So client ID equal to 2, you just have one extent over here, while you need 2 extents to scan here, right? Because 2 is in between these two. So even though client ID is a minor sort, right, it just needs to scan one extent here while it needs to scan 2 extents here. So the idea I'm trying to say here is that it does not depend on whether your column is a minor or a major sort. It may have to scan lesser or more extents in this architecture as opposed to a sorted table. All right, things to remember, you can have maximum of 4 columns as CBT columns. You can zone map additional data types like numerics, and it will impact the compression ratio, we saw that. It's a manual operation. Clustering is a manual operation. So you create a clustered base table, you always have to do a groom. Groom is like DB2's reorg, and then it will cluster your data. And any future updates or inserts will not be clustered. So as you lose the clustering, you will have to manually again do a groom. Okay? This is the way you create. You say create table and you give an organize one. Run stats, just like Neteza, just like DB2, Neteza is a cost-based optimizer. So it relies on efficient generate statistics, GenStats utility, for the optimizer to be able to choose optimum access plans. Things to remember about generate statistics, just like DB2, if your data has significantly changed, try to do a GenStats like you do in DB2 run stats. Just in time statistics. Now if you think about it, if you read the notes that I have, this is very similar to a statistical view in DB2. So what this just in time statistics does is it runs at query runtime and it collects dispersion values. Now dispersion values are just the opposite of cardinality. Dispersion values will tell you how many similar values are there in a column. So it runs at query runtime and collects dispersion values for tables greater than 500 million rows. Okay? What's the advantage of this? It helps query plan estimation when data is queued, more efficient cardinality estimation, and better evaluation of complex joins. Since this is collecting the stats on the join conditions, this is just like statistical views, and it helps you to avoid these data skews. Here's a table I drew here, so you can see that, for example, for an operation like insert, right? Neteza will automatically collect some statistics for you. It will collect min, max, row count, but it will not collect null values and dispersion statistics. So remember that if you want to collect full statistics, you should always manually run a GenStats operation. You should not depend on Neteza to automatically collect it, because Neteza will only collect the basic stats. Just like DB2's materialized query tables, Neteza has materialized views. what does it do? You are saying create materialized view view name, okay? So let's say over here you have three columns. So you're saying create materialized view, giving a name. You're selecting only column 1 and 3 from the base table, and you're ordering by column 1. So one interesting thing over here is when you do this, Neteza will create a virtual zone map on column 1. With this technique, you can actually zone map additional columns like varchars. This is also called partitioning, vertical partitioning of a table. The specific use case is you have a wide table with many columns. You just want to refer a few columns. So this may be a use case for that. It's automatically substituted by the optimizer. You can also query the materialized views directly. Materialized view data slices are co-located on the same SPUs as a base table. So always remember that you cannot change the hash keys of your materialized views. So whatever are the hash keys of your base table is where your materialized views will reside. It can leverage just-in-time stacks, and it can be used as an optimizer. It can be used by an optimizer as an index. What does that mean? Remember I was telling you, let's say you have 209 columns and you want to index the 209 column. What are you going to do? Because Neteza only will allow you to zone map first 200 columns. So if you create a materialized view on that 209 column and you say order by, it's going to create a virtual zone map on this column, right? 209th column. And that can be used by the Neteza as optimizer as an index can. So that's an indirect way to go out of that limitation of Neteza's 200 columns zone mappable feature. Some things to remember about materialized views. So if you have a lot of heavy DML activities, best is to suspend the view, update it, and enable the view. Order by the most restrictive columns, okay? You cannot use a where clause in the materialized view. So yeah, that's a sort of a disadvantage, right? You can do something like you can say on a system level, you can say materialize refresh threshold. So you can say, okay, for the whole appliance, if for whatever tables, the clustering is less than 70%, it'll automatically refresh this view. So you can set it that way. So you don't have to manually keep refreshing it. So DB2 has a load utility. So same way Neteza also has something called an NZ load. NZ load is a wrapper around external table architecture. Now this whole external table is very new to us, right? I mean, this whole thing doesn't exist in DB2. And I had a hard time understanding what really an external table is. I really had a hard time because I was always thinking it in terms of DB2. So what it is, let's say you have a comma separated file. Okay, so you have value, comma, and so forth. Now the CSV doesn't have any metadata associated with it. So what the external table will do is it will create a metadata on your file. So it will say, okay, this first column is, let's say, an employee name of data type varchar. The second is an employee ID of data type integer. And once you create this metadata is stored as a table on the SMP host. It's never stored on the SPUs, okay? As you read the notes, it will sort of make sense to you because it's hard to get it in the first attempt. So that's all what an external table is used for. And once you create this external table, you can use it for loading and unloading. We will see how that is. You can do loading from different kind of file systems. In Neteza, you can load from remote and local clients. And then, yeah, this is just the basic stuff that, you know, only basic statistics are collected and so forth. NZ load is a single transaction. So remember, if you're loading 100,000 rows, all of them will have a same transaction ID. NZ load produces two files, log file just like DB2, and a bat file which contains rejected rows. Just like DB2, you can give an exception table. There is an allow replay option. So if you are, let's say you're loading data and your CPUs go, your one of your bait server goes down and the system is down. When it comes up, it will automatically restart the load with this option. So let's look at an example. So we are saying NZ load, which is the name of the load utility, just like, you know, load in DB2. You are giving the database name, table name, data file. And this file is delimited on this, right? So this file is taken and loaded into the table. So this is just very, very similar to how you load a table in DB2. Very similar. External table is actually a database table, we saw that. It has a schema definition, we saw that. They are stored in hosts and not in SPUs. We also saw that. And there is something called transient external tables. Now, this is external tables created only during the operation of the load. Once that is done, it's dropped. Let's look at some examples. So we are saying create external table, right? And this is the name of the external table. Now you are giving the metadata to the external table. So you are saying this external table has employee ID of type integer, salary of type integer, okay? And you are saying using file. So this is your data file, comma separated file. Sorry, this is your pipe separated file, right? This is the delimiter. So also you can, another example is you can say create external table. You are giving the external table name. You are saying same as employee. So here you are saying that my employee table's metadata is same, and you want to apply the metadata of the employee table on this external table, okay? And you are saying using this data file, and you are saying delimiter is pipe. So well enough, I mean, you have created an external table which is stored, the metadata is stored in the host. So now what's the use of that? So now you're unloading data. You're saying insert into this external table, select all from employee. Now what will this do? This is just a metadata, right? This is not a table. This is a metadata on the file. So what this does, it loads the data from the employee table into a file, which is a pipe separated file, because you define it over here, right? Makes sense? I mean, this is a little different. I had a hard time understanding it. But the very idea is how you are using the external table as a metadata and loading into a file. So just the opposite. Now you are saying insert into this main table, okay? And you are saying select all from the metadata. So this metadata is used, this file is used, and the data is loaded into the employee table. Yes. You are exporting the data, but the way you are exporting the data is different, right? So external table is you are defining metadata, and then you are using that metadata to either load into a file or take the data from the file and load into a table. So this is an example of transient external tables. So it's saying insert into employee. This is your table, and then you are saying select all from external. You're giving the file name, right? And then this is just loading from a fixed format file. So it's saying integer, you know, first is integer of bytes 3, date of bytes 10, and so forth. So the way you define transient is you just say external and you give the file name. So this is a transient external table. And I have notes which will also give you more information about this usage. Now this is the interesting part. How does transactions work in Neteza? So in Neteza, there are some special rows. One is called a row ID. This is guaranteed to be unique in a table, but not necessarily sequential. And then there are two columns called create XID and delete XID, right? So the create XID and delete XID is always going to be sequential. So let's see how an insert operation works. So let's say this is a tuple I'm trying to insert into the table. So when I'm going to run the insert, I'm going to have a transaction ID of my insert statement. So this transaction ID gets written into the create XID. And the row ID, this is automatically generated by Neteza. So it, let's say in this example, it gives it 5,000, right? If I want to abort it, what does Neteza do? It doesn't get rid of this row. It just puts a 1 in the delete XID flag. What happens if I want to update it? This tuple is copied here. The same row ID is assigned here. 1049 here is the transaction ID of my update statement. It puts it here in create XID and delete XID 0. How to abort it? Simple, just put a 1 here and a 0 here. When Neteza scans the ones as delete XID, it knows that these are actually deleted rows. How to do a delete? Give the transaction ID of your create XID. Sorry, the transaction ID of a delete statement is put in delete ID. If you want to abort it, you simply put a 0 here. Now that's a reason aborting something in Neteza is super fast compared to DB2, right? But there's a problem with this. The problem is that you will end up over time with so many of these logically deleted rows. And this is bad because Neteza will need to keep scanning all of these useless rows for every SQL. And that's where the groom utility comes into picture. So the groom utility can be used for multiple purposes. One of the purposes is to get rid of all these logically deleted rows. You can also use the groom utility to recluster your CBTs. Okay, so and it has other uses as well. So it's very similar to DB2's reorg utility. transactions in Neteza. Neteza implements serializable isolation. So always remember, concurrent executions that are not serializable will not be permitted. Okay, and in this case, Neteza will simply roll back the youngest transaction. Neteza uses something called an invisibility list. So what is this? So let's say I'm trying to insert some data into a table. So Neteza will give me a transaction ID of my insert statement. Now I told that transaction IDs are always sequential in nature. So that means that whatever is already running or rolling back will have a transaction ID lower than my number. Okay? So my transaction ID will create an invisibility list, and it will contain any records that are created by these already executing or rolling back transactions. So any records that are already created but not committed will be excluded from my list. And any records that were deleted but not committed will be included in my list. So if you look at this invisibility list, you will be able to know that what your transaction ID will be able to see, right? And the same thing is also used for other utilities like backups and everything. So DB2's reorg, again, this is just like Neteza's groom utility is very similar to reorgs. So you can read this, I'll not go, it's pretty basic stuff. Okay, options for backup and recovery. So Neteza only has online backups. There's no possibility of offline. So everything is online in Neteza. You can backup only the schema, just like DB2, use for collecting the schema information? DB2 look. You can also backup the global permissions and groups. Now Neteza's permissions work a little differently, but remember at this point that the backup utility can be used to backup all the global users and permissions. It supports delta and cumulative backups. You can do a table level restore. This is really cool. You can take a backup image and restore just one table. In Neteza, the system catalog database we saw is in a different, the system catalogs are in a different database, right? System database. So your backup utility will not back it up. So there's a special utility called NZ host backup. You can use that to backup the system database. And this just tells you, you know, how to look at the logs and so forth. Some examples, you're saying NZ backup, you're giving the directory and you're saying users. So here you're backing up the global users and their permissions. So here you're backing up the production database, right? The name is ProdDB. Here you're doing a cumulative backup. Here you're doing a schema level backup. So you see, it's pretty, pretty, very, very similar to, you know, how a backup in DB2 would be. You know, the commands are very, very simple. As long as you understand what it's doing, it's very easy to catch on the commands. Restore, how does it work? So let's say you in a week, you are doing one full backup and few incrementals, right? So Neteza will give you a backup set ID for the whole backup set. So you can use that backup set ID to restore the database. So you can say, NZ restore, which is a utility for restoring, give the database name, give the directory, give this backup set ID, right? So this backup set ID, what it will do, it will take the full online backup and restore it. You can apply the incrementals. There are many ways to apply the incremental restores. You can say up to X restore. So if you say increment 2, it applies the next two incrementals on top of this full backup. You can do a step by step. If you keep saying increment next, and so on, it keeps applying one, the first backup incremental, then the second, and so forth. And you can also say increment rest. So over here you can say that, okay, I have restored my full backup. Now I know that there are 7 incrementals. Apply all of them. So right, so the rest will apply all of them. So all of these step-by-step restores, whenever you do, remember you always need to log the database. So this is how you log the database. Okay, Neteza's backup, some of the key things here to take away is Neteza's backup operation is fully online. You cannot do a full restore to an existing database. Now this is something really not good. You need to drop the database, create an empty database with the same name, and then do the restore. So they should fix this. This is how it works in Neteza, unfortunately. Neteza's backup is a multi-stream process. Restore is always a single stream process. So if you are trying to optimize backups and restore, always keep this in mind. Don't think that I have been able to get multi-stream backups, so now I'm going to do a multi-stream restore. That's not possible. Okay, and you have some tools like NZ admin, which is really good. You can do 90% of your administrative work to the NZ admin tool. Things to remember, so remember I was telling you that the system database, is backed up with a different utility, right, which is called the NZ host backup. Now let's say I took a backup of the system database on Monday, and on Friday I'm trying to take that backup of the system database and restore it. And now let's say between Monday and Friday, there were a few tables that got created. Now what's gonna happen if I restore the NZ host backup of Monday, right? The catalog is not gonna know about these tables that were created between this time. So in that case, Neteza will automatically flag these for delete, and it will give you the script to go and drop these tables. So that's the reason you should always do a NZ host backup on a regular basis. Because think about it, your backups are not doing a backup of your system catalogs, right? So you have to always make it a practice to backup the NZ host, which is your system database. That's something, you know, it's very easily overlooked because we try to think it in terms of DB2. Okay, these are all the basic stuffs again. How does database access work? So DB2 only relies on operating system for authentication. Neteza has two levels of authentication. So you can, it will first authenticate you at the operating system level, and then once you connect to the database will also have its own user ID and password management system. So there are two levels of authentication. Privileges can be at a global level, database level, or at a particular object. So when I give a global create table to Neteza appliance, that person can create tables in any databases in the whole appliance. It's a global privilege. Okay, and you can have database level and object level as well. It has two kinds of permissions. The first is object permissions. This kind of permissions will let you use the appliance. For example, you can do gen stats, you can do list, you can do insert, deletes, and so forth. Admin permissions will tell you how to, will give you the privileges to administer the database. So it's more like restore, backups, create database, and so forth. And DB2, you have utilities like DB2 EXFMT and DB2 Explain for collecting explain information. Neteza has explain, you give this utility and you give the SQL, you can generate multiple kinds of explain reports. All currently running SQLs and the ones which are already finished, all of these plans are stored in some directories in the host. So you can go to these directories and also you can look at all the plans. So DB2 has something like, so it has an audit facility and it has DB2 event monitors to help collect monitoring data and performance data, right? So Neteza relies on the history database. Now this is not created by default. This is something that you need to set up. But once you set up and once you define all of these load strategies, what it does is it collects all this performance data and it will load it into a staging area in the SMP host. And automatically this data gets loaded to a loading area, and from there Neteza will load it into the history database, right? And if there are any errors, it'll go to the error area. From here it can again try to reload the data. So this is how the performance data will be collected and loaded into the history database. How do we do it? We first create the query history database. There's a special utility to do this. Once you create the query history database, you would enable the configuration. So whenever you are enabling the configuration, you can tell what all you need to collect, right? So over here I'm collecting everything. I'm collecting plan, column, table, everything, right? But you can be restrictive. And over here you're giving how you want to load the data. So I'm saying over here that load it every 10 minutes. So once you define the configuration, you enable the query history, you give your users ability to access this database, and they can look at all the monitoring data, all the performance data. And Neteza also comes with a tool called NZ Portal, which gives you a GUI interface to look at all the monitoring data. It's very, very cool, very easy to use. You have all the monitoring data at your fingertips with the NZ Portal. Things to remember about Neteza: it supports user-defined functions using Java. If you install in the analytic packages, you can write UDFs in other languages. If you want to be creative, you can write it in Perl, Python, whatever you feel like. This is a very important feature of Neteza. So it comes with a set of stored procedures that can be used for data mining operations. So you know, in SaaS and other data mining applications, they have to pull all the data from the database. The reason is that they don't have the logic to do it in the database. So they pull all the data, Then they write SAS programs to work on the data set, and then they push it back into temporary tables in the database, right? So in Netezza, you have stored procedures with which you can create data models, you can do predictive analysis, you can do decision tree analysis. So all these are ready-made stored procedures. You don't have to write your own code. So you run that, the SAS interface will push the data, all of the processing will be done in Netezza and given back to you. So this is a very, very cool feature in Netezza, and this is very often not utilized to the fullest. Now people are not aware of it. It supports PLSQL. It has something like an NZ event. What is this? NZ event will help you generate different kind of alerts. So you can alert if your SPUs are down. You can alert if your temperature for your appliance goes up. So you can set up different kind of alerts and monitoring using this utility, NZ event. It comes with a workload management feature, just like DB2. So you can do different kind of workload management. You can say, I want to give certain resources to certain groups. Then it does short query biasing, which means that short and tactical queries will be pushed into Netezza and results given back. It will not have to wait for the long queries to finish. You can also give it priority to the queue during execution. So if your workload is waiting in the queue, you can give priorities of when to execute what, okay? It's basically a scale-out architecture. So you don't scale up a Netezza system, you scale out. So how you do it? You add units of SPUs. So which comes with units of memory, CPU, FPGAs, and disk. It has built-in high availability. The SMP host that we were talking about usually has an active and a standby configuration, so it can fail over in the event of an issue. There is high availability built-in in the SPU disks. It's rated to zero. So a copy of the data is always kept in another disk. So there is a rate zero protection. Redundancy is also built in to safeguard against CPU failures. So if one of your blade servers goes down, the other blade servers that are available will take the other data slices from that SPU and start working. So there is built-in redundancy and high availability built-in in all of these. And also it has now some options for disaster recovery. There are some special applications that you can download and you can use it for disaster recovery architecture as well. How to reach out to help? All the documentation is there in the IBM Knowledge Center. Just like DB2, you can find all the manuals, all the commands, everything in the IBM Knowledge Center. This was not there a year ago, so we had to go to different places. IBM has done a great job. Everything is here now in one place. There's a Pure Data NZ community, very, very active. You put a question over here, they'll always come back to you. They realize that this is a new technology, people are learning this, I'm also learning this. So they are a very, very active community. So if you need out for any help, they usually help you. So I guess I'm done with the presentation, so we can open the floor for any questions. Yes. Can you repeat that?
I've run into this from the point of view of the new appliance for Xenos. But you've described this as being very, very similar to the Share Nothing version of DB2.
Yes.
So why would you buy in Netezza?
So if you think about it, right, Netezza, it doesn't give you the features you do not need. Okay, you don't need primary keys, RIs, it doesn't give you, right? Whatever you don't need, it doesn't give it to you. It gives you the bare bone skeleton that is needed to run an analytics. Very, very specific for a certain kind of workload. So since it doesn't come with these bells and whistles, usually from a cost perspective, this is more efficient. Again, this is depending on how IBM is going to price the appliance, because they offer both the appliances. They have an appliance running on DB2, they have an appliance running on Netezza. But usually, there's a cost benefit associated with it. And the other thing is, the fundamental difference that you saw is the FPGAs, right? So what you're doing is you're processing data, processing the data towards the data. You're not pulling the data, which is the same concept that is being used by Hadoop and other big data technologies, where they're saying that push processing to the data, don't pull the data. So Netezza is one of the first ones to do that, actually. So this is one of the other reasons that it may be a good option to use Netezza. Because there's a fundamental difference on how data is getting processed.
servers compared to P servers per DB2.
So his question is, what are the operating systems on which Neteza is usually installed? Is that what your question is? So it always comes with Red Hat Enterprise Linux. So the host is running Red Hat Enterprise Linux. The SPUs are also running a Linux flavor, but it's all shielded from the user. You cannot access them. You don't have the option to run it on AIX or power machines. Well, the way the appliances are priced is, you know, IBM will price you on the appliance. They really will not. So they will price you on the appliance, and then they'll charge you for support. So depending, again, on how IBM is going to come up with the cost model, it totally depends on the relationship of IBM with the client and what's the cost model.
Okay.